on two computers. All right. Hello, good morning, good evening, good afternoon, everyone, wherever you might be. It is my great pleasure to welcome you to the North Atlantic Commutative Geometry Seminar. Today we have a very special topic and a very special speaker. And so I decided that instead of running it from home as usual, you know, unshaved and wearing my pajamas, I'm doing it from the Banach Center on professional equipment and via super fast wired internet. And you see, Stefan Banach is right here with us. He is new to Zoom, but he is very smart, so he is learning fast. And please allow me to mention, by the way, very briefly, that Banach Center is a very user-friendly conference center for organizing online meetings in mathematics. So if by any chance you think about organizing an online conference in mathematics, please think about the Banach Center. Let me give you an example. Just a few weeks ago, and Masoud can confirm because he was one of the lecturers, we had a conference on spectral geometry. And this was hosted by the Banach Center. And the ladies from the Banach Center, they prepared a beautiful poster. They hosted the meeting on Zoom, then recorded the lectures, uploaded them on YouTube, and they set up and ran the conference page. So we have all the things taken care of. And unlike in the Fields Institute, in the Banach Center, you as an organizer have a direct access to your homepage of your meeting. So of course, it's the most of the job is done for you by the staff. But if you want to correct the comma here and there, you can do it anytime you want 24/7 because you have direct access. So if you think about conference in mathematics online, think Banach Center. That's the end of the commercial. Now we can go and start the seminar. Our today's speaker needs no introduction. However, please allow me to say that he is a person who not only discovered and pioneered on commutative geometry, but also is always willing to share his enthusiasm and his excitement with us, which I find to be extremely precious. That's not the first time Alain speaks at this seminar. I think it's the second time. And today is very special because we go on Zoom. So the audience is already remarkable. The numbers are huge. So without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, Monsieur Dame, Alain Cohn, Alain, the Zoom is yours. Take it away. We are all ears.
Well, thanks a lot. Okay, so I hope you can hear me clearly. And I mean, I will present an exploration that we have been doing with Katia Consani. And I mean, I just want to recall to start that a few years ago, we wrote a book with Danny Chéreau and Jack Dixmier. And last Thursday, we celebrated the 97th. Birthday of Jacques Dixmier.
Wow.
And he's amazing. He's really an amazing man. You know, he really understands, for instance, what we are doing with Katia better than many, many people. Okay, so the topic of this book can be sort of read in the upper part, you know, in the part where you see this. And what happens in this book is that the hero is a mathematician. And I mean, he's sort of haunted by a spectrum, which he doesn't know what it is. And he spends essentially the whole book trying to discover that, in fact, this spectrum is given by the zeros of the Riemann zeta function. So this is how it looks, you know, when you look at the low-lying part of the zeros. And I mean, even though, you know, people have understood the fact that when you go quite far in the spectrum resembles the spectrum of an Hermitian random matrix, they have no clue whatsoever on the low-lying part of the spectrum. And so what I will explain today will start by a discovery which was made by people in Bell Lab in the 60s, and which will play an absolutely crucial role. So this discovery is the following. So, I mean, this is the spectrum as you should see it when the zeros, of course, I mean, because it is two-sided and you have a symmetry. And when you see this symmetry, of course, I mean, Michael Attia told me a long time ago that this looked like the spectrum of a Dirac operator. Anyway, so I mean, we shall start by this discovery of people working in Bell Lab that they did at the beginning of the 60s, and which is the following. I mean, there is a paradox in communication of signals. Why? Because, for instance, my talk is limited in time. Okay, the duration of the signal is limited. And also the range of frequencies which I'm going to use is, of course, limited. Now, why is this paradoxical? Well, because you see, these two functions are Fourier transform of each other. And I mean, we know very well that if you take a function with compact support, its Fourier transform is an analytic function, so it cannot have compact support. So you sort of, you know, you meet a contradiction from the very start. And because this is quite important in the actual communication of signals, Slepian and Pollack and also Landau found in the 60s something which is really a solution to this paradox, but which will play a key role in what I'm going to explain. And I mean, what they found is that even though it's not possible, of course, it's not possible to have a function which has compact support and this Fourier transform also has compact support. Well, you can really analyze this situation and understand that even though it's not strictly possible, it is true with an incredible precision, up to an incredible precision. So their paper is in 61 by Slepian and Pollack. And I mean, but if you look on internet for a picture of Slepian and Pollack, you don't get the same guys. And Slepian unfortunately died in 2007. Now, so mathematically speaking, what we are dealing with is a pair of projections. Why? Because you can consider functions which have support in the interval from minus lambda to lambda. We shall only deal with even functions. We won't bother about the other ones. And so if you call P lambda this orthogonal projection, you also have what it means that the Fourier transform has support between minus lambda and lambda. And what you do in order to get that, you just conjugate P lambda by the Fourier transform. By the way, it's Fourier transform, whether I put a minus or a plus, doesn't matter because the functions are even. And moreover, the inverse of the Fourier transform is the Fourier transform itself on even functions. So there is nothing complicated there. And now what you get is a pair of projections. Now, for us, we are operator algebraists. A pair of projections is something which we understand perfectly well. Why? Because giving a pair of projections, P1 and P2, is the same thing as to give a unitary representation of the dihedral group, the infinite dihedral group. Why? Because giving a pair of projections, a representation is the same as giving, if you want, a representation of the free product of Z mod 2Z by Z mod 2Z, where you replace the projection by unitary of square one by the obvious formula, where U1 is 1 minus 2P1 and U2 is 1 minus 2P2. And when you look at this group is in fact a semi-direct product of Z, generated, for instance, by U1, U2, and the symmetry, if you want, the symmetry of the group Z that replaces N by minus N. So it is this semi-direct product. And because it is this semi-direct product, just a moment thought, of course, I mean, you can use the Mackey representation theory of induced representation, but just think of it 1 second, and you will find out that the irreducible representations are at most two-dimensional. Now, because they are at most two-dimensional, you can make one of the projection to be this projection one, 0, 0. And then the other projection you compute and you find that it can be given in this form. Okay, I mean, up to conjugacy, of course, preserving P1, up to conjugacy by a diagonal matrix. So what you find out is that the irreducible representations, except for boundary cases, which I will not care about, are given by an angle, which is between 0 and π/2. And now when you work about the pair of projections, of course, the representation is not necessarily irreducible. It's a sum of irreducible representations. And so it's characterized by an operator angle. This angle operator commutes with P1 and P2, and it's given the simplest formula for it is the fact that the sine square of this angle, which is between an operator between 0 and π/2, is given by the square of P1 minus P2. I mean, it takes 1 minute or even less to check that P1 and P2 commute with P1 minus P2 squared. Okay, I mean, this you can amuse yourself with. Okay. So now what we have, we understand that in order to grasp, if you want, the relative position of two projections, it is the same as computing their angle, which is an operator in Hilbert space. Now, what Slepian and Pollack did, of course, they didn't formulate it in this way, but what they did, they found, if you want, a differential operator that actually commutes with P lambda and P lambda hat, and which will allow to compute the angle. Now, you see, it's very troublesome when you first see that, because you say, well, how can a differential operator commute with a function which is as discontinuous as a characteristic function of an interval? Doesn't look sensible at all. I mean, you know, if you think a bit, you find that the operator x d by dx commutes with the characteristic function of 0 infinity. Why is that true? It's true because the operator x d by dx generates a scaling group. It is a generator of a one parameter group, which is scaling. And of course, scaling preserves 0 infinity because you just rescale, you don't change the fact that something is positive. So this operator commutes with this continuous function, this characteristic function. And if you think a bit more, you'll find that the operator lambda square minus x square times dx commutes with now the characteristic function of the interval from minus lambda to lambda, because I put in front exactly the same thing as the x, which was here, in order that the zero wouldn't create trouble. You see, I made this operator not elliptic. It's not elliptic. It has a regular singular point at x equals plus or minus lambda. And okay, by working now quite a bit more, you will find that you can even put a d by dx in front, and this operator still commutes with the characteristic function of minus lambda lambda. Now, what Slepian and Pollack found is that the operator, which is here, this operator W lambda, which is beautiful. I mean, it has this principal symbol here, and it has an auxiliary term. And you can see that this operator is not elliptic, but because it has two regular singular points, again, at x equals plus or minus lambda. But it's a beautiful operator because it's invariant under Fourier. Okay, you can check that when you apply the Fourier transform, the previous one with the 2 pi, then this operator doesn't change. And now the beauty is that because of what we saw before, because this operator was commuting with a characteristic function of minus lambda lambda, this operator, of course, commutes with P lambda. But because it's invariant under Fourier, it also commutes with the Fourier transform of P lambda. So this means that now we have this pair of projections. But somehow, Slepian and Pollack, you know, they found that this pair is intimately related with the differential operator of order 2, which actually commutes with both of them. And hence, what will happen is that because it commutes with both of them, if you want, the sign of the angle will essentially, of course, be a function of this operator. I mean, it will be, if you want, of course, commuting with this operator. But and the eigenfunctions will be the same. So the eigenfunctions for this operator will give us eigenfunctions for the angle operator between P lambda and P lambda hat. And moreover, what Slepian and Pollack found, I mean, what they had a store, because this operator was known before them, and because this operator was actually appearing in the 1930s, when people tried to compute the Laplacian for the prolate spheroid. So the prolate spheroid is just a rugby ball. Huh? It's this. So it's called prolate because if you want, it's elongated in the direction of the axis of rotation. It would be called oblate in the other case. So it turns out that this operator was known. It was known before. And how did it appear? It appeared because when people tried to compute the Laplacian and its eigenvalues and so on for this object, three-dimensional object, then they found, I mean, this object is coming from what are called prolate coordinates, okay, which are, they look a bit strange, but they are very nicely devised, if you want. X and Y and Z are given in terms of A, B, and C. Of course, the cos and sine are the fact that you are taking rotation invariant, you know, you have a rotation axis. And when you write the Laplacian in these coordinates, what you find the beautiful thing that essentially the Laplacian up to a factor of a square minus b square, it's really the sum of two prolate operators, the operators W lambda acting on different variables. So then if you want the spectrum and all the diagonalization and so on can be done by separation of variables. So somehow, I mean, if you want the Slepian and Pollack, they had a store to use because they could use the fact that many properties of the eigenfunctions of this operator were known. And I mean, what is quite amazing is that by using all this data, which was available at this time, then what did they find? They find that the eigenfunctions, which are called prolate spheroidal wave functions, so I mean they are characterized, if you want, by an equation, which is a kind of integral equation. I mean, it says essentially that when you take the Fourier transform of the function psi m truncated between minus lambda and lambda, so I mean you take the function to be zero elsewhere, it's really located in this interval from minus lambda to lambda, but when you take its Fourier transform, then you get a multiple of itself for the values which are in the interval minus lambda lambda. I mean, these notations are what you find in a computer, but and they are, if you want, already there in the computer, so they can be used for calculation in a very, very efficient way. Now, so what the previous equality means, it means that when you take the compression of the Fourier transform by P lambda and you apply it to one of these prolate spheroidal wave functions, you get a multiple of the function. Now, you get a multiple of the function, there is a sign, okay, which depends on the M that you take. But what the beauty is that it gives you the cosine of the angle. And the cosine square of the angle is given by this eigenvalue square, chi of nu m square. Now, when you look at the values, I mean, at these eigenvalues, when you look at what they are, what you find out is that, for instance, here I took 3.8 or something like that. What you find out is that, wow, amazingly, I mean, these eigenvalues for this first value of m are indistinguishable from one. If you look at their numerical value, here is the first, for instance, the first numerical value. I mean, you know, so the computer essentially cannot distinguish them from one. And then, okay, they become further and further, but I mean, this one, for instance, is incredibly close to one. And after a while, they are no longer, okay, they are no longer. And so what happens is the following. What happens is that up to in a range of values of m, which is up to lambda square essentially, these eigenvalues are almost equal to one. Now, the fact that they're almost equal to one tells you that the cosine of the angle is almost one, and it tells you that the angle is almost zero. So what does it mean? It means that even though there was no intersection between these two projections, there is something which is incredibly close to an intersection because the angle between the corresponding vector is almost zero with an incredible precision. And so this is, if you want, what Slepian and Pollack were using for transmission of signals, but of course for us, it would play a key role. So when you look at these eigenvalues, I mean, this chi of mu and n, what you find is that what happens is that if you take a fixed value, for instance, the value 4 here, then all the previous ones which have already climbed up to one, they will be essentially equal to one. And when you look at the value, as I showed before, for instance, if I take mu equals 3.8, then I get essentially seven eigenvalues. So I get, if you want, seven functions which are orthogonal to each other and which are essentially in the intersection of the two projections. And what do these functions look like? Okay, when you plot their graph, the first one, remember that it's essentially equal to its Fourier transform. So it's incredibly located. Remember that the value we are talking about here is the square root of 3.8. So I mean, it's almost equal to two. So this function is it's support, I mean, it's incredibly close to zero when you reach the boundary of the interval. So it's essentially located there. And it's Fourier transform also because it's equal to its Fourier transform up to a very small thing. Now, when you take the second one, okay, it's still the same. I mean, this function, you know, acquires vibrations. So, I mean, in general, the n is related to the number of oscillations. And when you look at the next one, okay, it's still very much located in the interval. You can keep going, but you have to be careful because after a while, it cannot be located in the interval. Okay, and so the next one is this one. It's still pretty well located in the interval. And as I said, I mean, being essentially the same as its Fourier transform, the same holds for the Fourier transform. And then you continue, and you have this one. And then you continue, you have this one. Okay, this one begins to be a little bit tangential because of the value here. And then when it takes the next one, no, the next one is out of the screen. Okay, so this is what they discovered. And I mean, what we shall do is we shall use these functions to condition the Dirac operator on the circle. That's all we shall do. Okay, so we are using these functions. And as I will explain, what we have to do, we want to be able to apply the formula to these functions, which is, if you want, which is a Poisson formula. And the Poisson formula is well known in the framework of mathematics to be the incarnation of the Riemann-Roch theorem. So remember this name of the Riemann-Roch theorem, it will play a role later. So what we want to do, we want to take these prolate functions and we want to average them, okay? But in order to apply the Poisson formula, we have to make them fulfill the conditions that they vanish at zero and their Fourier transform vanish at zero. Now, this is not difficult because these functions are almost their Fourier transform. And so it's enough to make them vanish at zero. Then the other condition will be automatically fulfilled. So what we do instead of taking the psi n, I mean for n even and n odd, we make them vanish at zero by this combination. This is very easy to do with a computer. So this is a very easy step. And then we are there. And then what we do, we define the orthogonal projection on the finite dimensional space for each value of lambda, which is given by taking k of this function, where k is smaller, of course, than the value where you know the angle is no longer zero. So in fact, what one does is one computes the components of this epsilon of phi n on the orthonormal basis of the Hilbert space. So the Hilbert space would be L2 functions, okay, on the interval, which are with a periodic boundary condition. And the way one computes it, one, if you want, the computation can be done with the computer, even though you would think that this formula is an infinite formula because it involves all integers. What happens is that it's not an infinite formula because the function being located in the interval, which is from values less than lambda, when you take phi n of r u, where an integer r, then this will vanish as soon as r is bigger than lambda. So in fact, the sum is truncated to the r, which are between one and lambda. And I mean, there will even be cases where lambda will be like the square root of 3.8. So it's smaller than two, and then there would be no summation. It would just be the function that Slepian and Prolet Pollack found. So, I mean, this is a basic formula. So this is a basic formula. And with this formula, one defines an orthogonal projection, okay, which I call pi of lambda and k. And now we are ready. We are all set. But you have to remember that behind the scene, there is this Riemann-Roch and this Poisson formula, which is behind the scene because of this equality here. The point being that this equality allows you to compute only for lambda which are bigger than one, because you can use the same formula for lambda smaller than one. So this is what you do. Okay, this is what you do. And now here is the spectral triple. So here is our guy. So the spectral triple is the following. The functions are the functions on the circle, which is a quotient of the multiplicative real by powers of mu. Of course, you can take the log. So I mean, it's a circle of length L, where L is log mu. The Hilbert space is the Hilbert space of L2 functions on the same space, on this circle. Okay, and of course, I mean, as the Hilbert space is the same, Hilbert space doesn't see the boundary condition. So it's the same as this one. And what is the operator? Well, the operator is a finite rank perturbation of Dirac. So the Dirac is here. It's minus I du by du, which is a scaling operator because we are in the multiplicative group. And the perturbation is by this finite rank projection, pi of lambda k, which has dimension k, in fact. And so what you do is you compress the operator, d0 of lambda, by this 1 minus pi of lambda k. What does this mean? This means that you force these prolate functions to be in the kernel of the Dirac operator. That's all you do. This formula is a formula which tells you, which is the natural way to force these prolate functions to be in the kernel of the Dirac operator. So that's all you do. And now we have a circle of length log mu, okay, of length L, and we have the Hilbert space, we have the algebra, and we have the operator. And now we can explore. Now we can explore. Of course, the exploration will be done with a computer. I mean, you know, this is the type of thing that if you wanted to do it by hand, it would be strictly impossible. So now we rely on the computer and we explore. Okay, so we started exploring. Okay, we started exploring, and what did you find?
Excuse me.
A simple small value of mu. And when you take this small value of mu, the values of the angle are extremely close to zero, if you want, or cosine very close to one for 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then, okay, they are given by this. So they are still extremely close to one, except that, you know, when you reach 11, they are no longer close to one. So this says that the boundary value here, which is 10, okay. Now we look at the corresponding range of values that have to be evaluated, and it's around up to the value 34. And we compare the eigenvalues of our Dirac operator with the spectrum of zeta. So the eigenvalues are on the left, and the values, the imaginary part of zeros of zeta are on the right. And the first surprise that you have is, wow, it starts with 14. I mean, you know, this is sort of unbelievable, because when you look at the spectrum of the operator itself, it doesn't start with 13 at all, with 14 or whatever. I mean, it starts very close to zero, but now it starts with 14. And the second one looks not too bad. Next one, not too bad either, you know, and you keep going like that. Okay, and you know where to stop because, okay, there is a very simple estimate. So what I will now show you, I will show you the results of this, you know, exploration. And in the exploration, I will show you the same thing as what I showed you for 5.5. So we're exploring. And of course, to compare with the zeros of zeta, I will show you this spectra, you know, with a rainbow, of course, in the background. Okay. So now you go to the next one, you go to 6.5. When you go to 6.5, you find that the boundary value is 12. So, I mean, it grows by 2 each time. And all the values are almost 1 up to 7. And then, okay, then they get a little bit. Okay, so this is fine for the cosine of the angle. So this tells you, if you want, that because of this angle stuff and so on, there are 12 dimensions of where the intersection is really non-trivial is 12. Okay, and then you compute the eigenvalues and you compare with the even zeros, and this is now you get, you see, this is very close to 14. This is not much out of 14. And you look, okay, and you look, oh, wow, well, okay, you know, okay. And you compare these two spectra, which are there, okay. Now you keep going. You take 7.5, okay, 7.5, of course, the value up to 9, they are almost 1 and so on. And then you compare. Okay, you know, you say, well, okay, I mean, it's strange, you know, now it's 15, how can it be? Then it's 21, okay, 24.9, which is very good, 30, which is good, 33, okay, and you keep going like that, okay? So I have shown you 7.5, okay, and this is how it looks. Look good because, you know, there is this sort of gap which is coming up now, so, okay. Now you take 8.5, you get these values up to 1, And they will stop being good after 16, essentially. So, I mean, each time it grows by two. Okay, and now you look at the value. Okay, so here are the values. Here are the values again, and so on. Okay, okay, so this was 8.5. And okay, it looks like this. Now begin to be okay to say, you know, it's not too bad. Then you take 9.5. You do the same type of calculations. Okay, and you compare. So again, very close to 14. 21, 25, 30, okay. So, I mean, you know, you look at these things, okay. That was 9.5. This is how it looks now, you know, it begins to resemble nicely, I mean, you know, so. And then you look for 10.5. 10.5, now it will go up to 20, essentially, yeah. The dimension of the intersection. Look at what happens. Now you are allowed to compare the value up to 65, which is a lot of values for the zeros of zeta, okay. And you compare them, and this is what you find. And so you find, you know, that they really resemble the low-lying zeros of zeta. Okay, so they really resemble. And then when you look at the spectrum, well, look, I mean, there is this gap here. There is also this gap here, there is this gap here. So what the hell, what is going on? What can we understand from this? And so I told you about Riemann-Roch. And at this point with Katia, we had the impression that there was a devil which was sort of fooling us, you know, making a fool of us. Because, okay, I mean, it was saying like, come on, I mean, you know, it's almost this, but it's not this, okay? So immediately when I think about this devil, I mean, I cannot resist of showing you this picture. I mean, this picture is when Grothendieck was making fun of himself. Because he was saying that there was a cooking of sorceries, you know, here, of witches. He was kind of burning his own Riemann-Roch theorem. This is a Riemann-Roch formula of Grothendieck. And Grothendieck was saying that, you know, his Riemann-Roch formula is so complicated that he has to talk for 2 hours to the audience before the audience can understand anything. And that in black and white, it takes about 500 pages. And then he says that it is some kind of delirium because the life on Earth is going to disappear. And he concludes by saying that it's time to change road. So, I mean, of course, I mean, I couldn't resist to show you this because it's Riemann-Roch and also because of the devil. Now, with Katia, of course, we try to understand what was behind this resemblance. So what was behind this spectral similarity? How could it be that we got things which were so similar? What could be the explanation behind that? Now, I will show you, of course, I mean, we finally got the explanation, otherwise I wouldn't give this talk. And I mean, it was done by accident. We found that when one compares the eigenvalues, when you change slightly the number, the dimension of the prolate projection, when you replace 2L by 2L plus 1, then something which I will show you immediately happens. Then we looked at the evolution of the eigenvalues as function. Then we found the quantization criterion, okay? And then finally, we looked at this. So, but let me show you what we found accidentally. So accidentally, we plotted together the eigenvalues for the 2L and for the even number of prolate conditions and for the odd number of prolate conditions. I mean, it's an exercise to show that the eigenvalues for the latter are smaller than for the former. And what we found is amazing. When we looked at the first eigenvalue, of course, they are different because these things, you know, they are, they move with the lambda. But what we found is that they were touching for special values of the lengths. And when they were touching, they were the values, the common values that they had was exactly the zero of zeta. That was an experimental fact, a discovery which was done experimentally for the first eigenvalue. Okay, well, then you can say, okay, it works fine for the first eigenvalue. What about if you try the second eigenvalue? Well, we looked at the second eigenvalue and exactly the same phenomenon was occurring. Namely, the fact that these eigenvalues touched, these graphs were touching each other for certain values of lambda. And when they touched each other, they were now coinciding exactly with the second zero of zeta. Okay. And then we continued. And we, for instance, we looked at the fourth eigenvalue. It was exactly the same. Now, you see, when you look at that, you can be a little bit surprised by the fact that these graphs, I mean, they are discontinuous. Why they are discontinuous? Because you put as many conditions as you can so that the dimension of the space is as big as you can to condition the operator. So, I mean, the next thing to do is not to put things discontinuously, but it is to look at how, if you want, okay, so I will come back to that later, but it is to look at really the evolution of eigenvalues. Namely, now I will fix the number of conditions and I will move now the lambda, or if you want, I will move the length of the circle. And what happens now when you do that, what happens now is that you get the following graph. So what you get, it's something which is truly amazing because now these curves are continuous, they are even analytic functions. So, and they represent the eigenvalues of the corresponding operators. But what happens is that these eigenvalues, the graphs of these eigenvalues, they touch each other, okay, in several points. And when they touch each other, this is for the first eigenvalue, exactly coincide with the first zero of zeta. And moreover, if you look at this picture for long enough, you will have the idea that in fact, these points, they form a geometric progression. And all of these facts will be justified by the mathematical theorem that we shall prove, okay? So, but I mean, this was an experimental observation. I mean, it's an observation that you could never do if you were just working by hand. I mean, you have to use a computer in order to do it. Okay, so that's, if you want, the second observation. And the third observation that we did was to understand that in fact, these points where the graphs meet, okay, like this one and so on, okay? In fact, they are not arbitrary points in the plane. They satisfy a quantization condition, which is the condition that x to the power I, y is equal to one. I mean, how did we get the idea of this condition? We got the idea because you can look at the spectrum of the operator, which is unperturbed. You can look at the operator, the Dirac operator, without the conditioning. And what you will find out is that if you look at this spectra, they fulfill exactly this condition. This is a very easy exercise because, I mean, it is a scaling operator. So then, okay, we tried to see if this quantization condition is fulfilled by the previous, by this point of intersection. And what do you find with the computer? Okay, this one works. Okay, the next one works also. The next one works also. And the next one works also. So this cannot be, you know, this cannot be an accident. What it means is that not only these curves, they touch each other, but where they touch each other, the condition of quantization is fulfilled. And I mean, and there are no, when you look at the solutions of x to the i, y is equal to one, I mean, there will be no other points. So then you can compute with a computer, you can compute the quantization condition for the first eigenvalue, for the second eigenvalue. And what you find is that the points where it holds are exactly the same point as where the graphs meet. But now you are no longer talking about the graph. And so, and finally, we had the idea that in fact, when, because the quantization condition was fulfilled, should be true that in fact the eigenvectors for the perturbed operator should be the same as the eigenvector of the unperturbed operator, which has the same rotation number. And then we used this criterion. We use this criterion to compute something which ought to give us the zeros of zeta. And okay, so here was what you get for first eigenvalue, second, and here is what we got. So now you see, I cannot even tell you which one is the zeros of zeta and which one is what we computed. What I can tell you is the probability that by doing this randomly with a random idea, you would get the same result. And the probability that you would get the same result is 10 to the minus 50. In other words, it's 0.00000 with 50 zeros. So in other words, in order just to get this 31 first zero of zeta, okay, I didn't have to define the Riemann zeta function. Okay, and I was just computing spectra of operators. And this is the coincidence that you get. So, I mean, of course, when you have such a coincidence, you have to find the explanation. There has to be a mathematical explanation. Okay. And so what is the mathematical explanation? Very strangely, this mathematical explanation will again bring the name of Riemann in the front. Why does it bring the name of Riemann in the front? Because the conceptual explanation will be related to Riemann sums in integration. And in fact, it will be related to what I will call immediately scale invariant Riemann sums. Okay. So what do I mean, Riemann sums in integration? Well, you see, if you think a little bit about the map E, which I had defined, this map E, in fact, the right hand side of the map E is just a Riemann sum for the integral of a function. But because we assume that the integral of the function is zero, when we look at this sum, I mean, of course, to have the Riemann sum, you wouldn't have the power 1/2 here, you would have u, okay? And so if I put u to the power 1/2, then what will happen is that normally I would get a divergence, but this divergence doesn't occur because the integral is zero. So you get something which is interesting, and you can make this interesting thing into something even more interesting by making it scale invariant, namely by rescaling it by mu, by powers of mu over z, and then you get a periodic function on r plus star divided by mu to the z. Now, once you have done that, you can define a zeta cycle. So a zeta cycle by definition is what? It's a circle. I call L its length and it's log mu because it's a quotient, if you want, of r plus star by powers of mu, which is such that the subspace, which is obtained by taking sigma mu epsilon of S0, namely by taking the image of the scale invariant Riemann sums, okay, is not dense in the Hilbert space L2 of the circle. This is a completely, I didn't have to use anything else. This definition of what we call a zeta cycle. This definition was extracted from the numerical results, okay? Now, what happens is the following, is that what we proved with Katia, we proved the following theorem, abstract theorem. So if you take a zeta cycle, if you look at the spectrum of the action of the multiplicative group on the orthogonal complement of the scale invariant Riemann sums in the L2 space of the circle, this spectrum is formed by imaginary parts of zeros of zeta on the critical line, okay? Conversely, if you take the imaginary part of a zero on the critical line again, then any circle whose length is an integral multiple of 2 pi over s is a zeta cycle and its spectrum contains is. So this theorem, okay, this theorem has two parts. The first part tells you that if you have a zeta cycle, the spectrum of the action of scaling is formed by imaginary parts of zeros on the critical line. And conversely, if you have a zero on the critical line, then automatically, you have not only one circle, but you have all, if you want, the coverings of the circle, which I'll see immediately why, which are zeta cycles, but which give you IS in the spectrum. Now, this theorem completely explains what happened previously. Because what it means, in fact, the computation, what they mean, is that for the special values, if you want, where the K dependence was disappearing, what it meant exactly that one had a zeta cycle. And moreover, the value lambda n, yes, n second value, was in the spectrum of this zeta cycle. Moreover, you know, the experimental observation that they formed a geometric progression is exactly saying that the L, which is the log of mu, form an arithmetic progression. And the scale ratio of the arithmetic progression is 2 pi over the zeta value. So it gets smaller and smaller and smaller when the N increases. What does it mean? It means that these graphs, they are stuck because they are riveted to the zeta cycle points. So they can take other values, but because they are riveted to the zeta cycle points, they have to resemble the zeros of the Riemann zeta function. Okay, so I mean, okay, so this is what happens. And one thing which is very striking is that, in fact, these zeta cycles, they behave exactly like closed geodesics. Because if you take a zeta cycle, one can prove that for any integer n, the n-fold cover of the zeta cycle is still a zeta cycle. This follows very easily from the definition. So, of course, this has a very powerful suggestive content. What does it mean? It means that there ought to be somewhere, but we didn't find, there ought to be a kind of a mystical cusp which has closed geodesics, and these closed geodesics correspond exactly to these zeta cycles. And we know very well, if you want, that when you take closed geodesics, when you take a cover of a closed geodesic, it's still a closed geodesic. Okay. Now, the next steps, so I put this with an interrogation point because, of course, we didn't find this yet. Okay. But the next steps, in fact, they will tell you what is the origin of this work, which is, of course, you know, with Katia, we have been working on the veil positivity. And the next step are, first of all, the link with the veil positivity, which is which I will immediately explain. And then, not only that, but then there will be this remarkable fact that the parameter space, the L space, if you want, the space where L was taking its values, it turns out to be the scaling site, which we had discovered with Katia, and which was, of course, related to the Adel class space. So I will explain in great detail these two points. So first of all, the link with the veil positivity, which was in fact the motivation of what we did, is the following. You see, one knows from the work of Veil that, from Riemann and Veil, one knows that there is the explicit formula. The explicit formula relates, if you want, the value of the Fourier transform of a function on the zeros of zeta. I mean, of course, here I put with 1/2 plus IS, okay, involving all zeros. It relates this with the sum, which is the sum over the places of the global field Q, which involves the primes and which involves also the Archimedean place. Now, the right-hand side, what happens with the right-hand side, it's very interesting, is that if the function F has compact support, then the right-hand side, the summation in the right-hand side is finite. And the reason why it's finite is that when you take this contribution of a prime, it vanishes for all functions whose support is in smaller than where the prime first appears. So in fact, this is computable. This is a computable expression on the right-hand side when you restrict to functions whose support is contained in the interval lambda inverse lambda. This will be the same as the lambda we were talking about before. So now the Veil quadratic form, of course, because of the explicit formula, is written as a sum over the zeros, and it can be computed this way. So it is suitable for numerical exploration. And with Katia, what we were doing, we were exploring this functional beyond the case that we had treated in a previous paper on the Veil positivity, which means in intervals which are larger than between 1/2 and 2. And at first, when you look for L between 0 and log 2, so which means if you want for mu around 2, what you find out is that it's positive. Okay, this was actually first proved by Yoshida. And you can look, but you do that with a computer. And what you find out, for instance, is that if you forget the contribution of the prime 2, then the function becomes negative. So, you have to really to use all the terms in the explicit formula. And this is how, if you want, they correct. The bad one is the yellow one without the contribution of the prime 2. But if you add the contribution of the prime 2, everything goes fine. Okay, and you continue like this. But what we really discovered numerically with Katia is that when you look at, when you look for larger values of mu, amazingly, what happens is that the Veil quadratic form admits incredibly small eigenvalues. They're still positive. The computer is still able to tell you that something which is of the order of exponential of minus 60 is positive. Okay, so they are still positive. Of course, you have to trust the computer pretty much. Eh? I mean, you have, of course, to fine tune the computer so that it can do this type of computations. But what does it mean? What does it mean that if you want the Weyl functional admits eigenvalues which are incredibly small? So this is the smallest eigenvalue, this is the next one, and so on. What does it mean? Well, in fact, you know, the explanation can be understood quite well, because it turns out that if you would not restrict the functions to have their support in a fixed interval, compact interval, what would happen is that the Weyl functional would have a radical. In fact, it would have an infinite dimensional radical, which would be the image of the map E. I mean, that's what, you know, I had sort of stressed in my paper in 1999. And so what happens now, what happens is that, okay, well, you can look at it for the odd matrix, of course, it's similar. And what you can do now, you can look at the corresponding eigenvector, because of course, the computer can also compute the corresponding eigenvector. So you look at the graph of the corresponding eigenvectors for the Weyl quadratic form, and you find, you know, you find this type of thing and so on. And then you begin to think, And after some time, okay, after some time, you have this fundamental fact which we found and which was our motivation. What you find is that the space of eigenvectors, when you look at the k lowest eigenvalues for the Weyl quadratic form, q, w, there is a lambda in the Weyl quadratic form because you restrict functions to have their support between lambda inverse and lambda. It turns out that this corresponds to the prolate projection for the spectral triple. And so what is the conceptual reason behind this? Conceptual reason I want to explain because it's related to Riemann-Roch and it's extremely important. What is the conceptual reason? As I said, if I wouldn't restrict the support of the functions, the map E would land in the radical of the Weyl quadratic form. Why would it land in the radical of the Weyl quadratic form? This is easy to understand because the Weyl quadratic form involves, if you want, the evaluation of this Fourier transform on the zeros. But the map E is essentially the multiplication by zeta in Fourier. So when you take something which is in the range of the map E, it will vanish, so it will be in the radical. Okay. Now, this is fine, but how can we then handle this while we are only dealing with functions which have compact support? Now, these functions which have compact support, they cannot be, they cannot vanish on all zeros of zeta. Why? Because by holomorphic function, by the growth of holomorphic functions, you know that these functions are of exponential type, which is limited by the size of the interval. And so their zeros, by general theorems on zeros of holomorphic functions, do not grow more than linearly. On the other hand, you know, the zeros of the Riemann zeta functions, they grow more than linearly because they, the number of zeros grows like E log E. So, I mean, there cannot be something in the radical. So what happens? Well, what happens is that the formulas which I showed you when I was defining the projection pi of lambda k, what they were doing were, they were using the map E and they were saying, okay, you see the function itself is limited up to lambda, the prolate function, limited up to lambda. So when you take the sum by the map E, of course, it's still limited up to lambda because you take f of x and f of 2x, f of 3x. I mean, it still vanishes when x is bigger than lambda. So it's limited there. But now by Poisson, by the Riemann-Roch, if you want, by the Poisson formula, if the function was also such that its Fourier transform would be limited by lambda, then the same would hold for the function of x inverse. So now it would be in the map, the range of the map E, and it would be in the interval lambda inverse lambda. We saw that this is impossible. It's impossible, but it's almost true. And it's almost true because of what Slepian and Pollack found. Okay. And so now, of course, one has to compare. So the computer will give us the eigenvectors for the Weyl quadratic form. And it will give us also this prolate construction, and they have to be compared. And we did the comparison. And the comparison here is the following. You will see, and it will be obvious later. The comparison is done by drawing the graphs of the two functions. And when you see only one function, it means that the second graph is hiding the first graph. So the two functions agree magnificently, okay? So here we have compared them for the values of mu, which for the eigenvectors, which are between 3.5, which is less than 4, and 11. And note that when you take mu equals 11, the eigenvalue is 10 to the minus 48, which is really amazing. It's really amazing that the computer can actually compute the eigenvector, and then you compare it with the prolate function, and puff, it fits on the nose. And I want to show you some other graphs rather fast, just to show you what happens when you go out of the range of applicability of this coincidence. Okay, so the next one for the odd matrix is again beautiful. I mean, you know, it cannot be better. I mean, the graphs are, the second graph is hiding the first one, the functions agree amazingly. And then you keep going, okay, now you look at the second smallest eigenvalue. So, okay, you are requiring already more. And I mean, it's clear if you want that when you look at the second smallest eigenvalue, you cannot hope for coincidence for two small values of mu, because for two small values of mu, there is only one very small eigenvalue. Okay, so you continue, you continue, you continue for the odd matrix, okay? And now you can see, these here, they don't agree. And of course they don't agree, they shouldn't agree. They shouldn't agree because you don't have a small eigenvalue at that level, a third smallest eigenvalue for the wave function. So they don't agree. But you can see what was achieved by the others, because the others, they were really hiding. This one is not hiding. I mean, you know, the yellow one is not hiding the blue. I mean, the blue is there. And then you continue, okay, you see now, oh, they are not hiding at all. The first two, of course, later it's fine. And then you keep going and you see that, of course, you have to start later and later because you have less. I mean, here I am talking about the fourth smallest eigenvalue. So of course you have to go on. Okay, so you keep going. And I mean, of course, I mean, the power of the computer is amazing for that because you can check. I mean, it's not that you know, sometimes we are always afraid to make a mistake in computations. Here, it can't be the case. I mean, you know, the computer is telling you, you are right, I mean, you know. And when you are wrong, it tells you also. I can't tell you. Okay, so you keep going like that. Okay, you keep going like that. And okay, so here I'm already at the sixth smallest eigenvalue. Okay, and now, okay, so now if you want what we have done, we have understood that these projections, this prolate projection, should play an absolutely fundamental role for the understanding of the positivity of the wave function, just because they give you, they provide for you the eigenvectors which make it impossible to check numerically. You see, I mean, Yoshida was able to check numerically for the value 2, but as soon as you go to a value which is beyond, I would say 6 or something like that, you cannot, because the eigenvalues are so small that you cannot be sure that the computer is doing the computation right. And it's not a minus something, very tiny, but it could be a minus, and you never know. So, I mean, our next surprise with Katia, which was an amazing surprise, was that when you take the parameter space for these zeta cycles, or for the circles, if you want, you find the topos that we know very well, which is the scaling site, and which is the semi-direct product of zero infinity by n cross. Now, zero infinity is because it is the length of the circle, so this is L. And n cross because you take coverings of the circle. So, I mean, the n cross is acting by coverings, by going to coverings. And what happens, if you want, is that these subspaces, they generate a subsheaf. So, of course, the Hilbert spaces of the circles, they form a sheaf. And then you can consider the subspaces which come from these scale invariant Riemann sums. They generate a subsheaf of modules over the sheaf of smooth functions. And then you can consider the cohomology of the quotient sheaf. And what you find is the following. What you find is that the cohomology H0 of the scaling site with coefficients in the quotient sheaf, it gives you the isomorphic, it's isomorphic to the spectral realization. But again, this spectral realization is of the critical zeros of theta. Okay, and now if you want, unlike in my paper in 1999, In my paper in 1999, I had to use Sobolev spaces, which were quite unnatural, to have only the critical zeros. But here, you have only the critical zeros. That's it. You know, there is no question. The Hilbert space is L2. I mean, there is no Sobolev space or anything like that. I mean, it's just a critical zero. So, of course, I mean, if one could prove the explicit formula in that setup, okay, one would have. And but now there is more. There is more that we have done with Katia, which is that somehow, you know, of course, one would like this cohomology to be an H1, not an H0. And it turns out that the reason why it is an H1 and not an H0 is the following, is that if one wants to understand conceptually the map E, I mean, this map, which I have been using many times, in fact, what appears is that one should use the following geometric construction. The geometric construction is that over the scaling site, which is the base, there is in fact a natural sheaf, if you want, of geometric spaces. And what are these geometric spaces? They are the projective space, PS1, I will come back to that, over an S algebra, which is the quotient of the adels by, if you want, the kernel of the module map when you go to mu to the z. Maybe for that I have to switch and I have to write on the, so let me try to switch to my iPad. So this might take a few seconds. I hope I will be able to do it. I mean, because these things, one never knows what happens when one tries to do that. Let me see. Okay, so now I have to do that. I have to, this is terrible. Okay, so I am trying to copy the screen. Okay, yep. And now
you can see your iPad, yes.
Okay, and now I will get a white page. Okay. Yep. Okay, so I get a white page.
Yes.
Now you see what happens is that in the work we did with Katia, we wanted to understand what was the nature of the Adelkra space. Now we wanted to understand what was the algebraic nature of the Adelkra space. So here, by the Adelkra space, what do I mean? I mean, I take the Adels over Q, okay, and I divide them by Q cross. Now, in what I am explicitly explaining now, what I call the algebra A sub mu, it's something even simpler, which I do. I mean, I divide, if you want, I consider the module map, which goes from the Adel, from the, in fact, I consider, if you want, the module map, which goes from the Idel, sorry, from the Idel, so which is A star, if you want. Okay, sorry. So, so I consider the Idels, A star Q. I consider the module map, which goes to R plus star. Okay, and I consider the inverse image of mu to the Z. So I consider mod inverse of mu to the Z. So this is a subgroup which I call G mu of the Idels. And now what I want to consider, I mean, this algebra A mu, it's really the quotient of the Adels of Q by G mu. Now you see, when you look at this and you think in ordinary terms, you are totally perplexed because the quotient of a ring by a group, which is in fact a subgroup of this ring, that doesn't have any good mathematical sense. In fact, it has a beautiful sense in terms of what are called S algebras. And what we had done with Katia was to develop, so now let me even put blue. Okay, we had developed, if you want, algebraic geometry. Of S algebras. Now it turns out that this is a notion which is due to.
I think the screen is frozen.
Sorry?
Screen is frozen now, I think, your screen.
Can I do what?
Your screen is frozen. I think we don't see you right. It's Ludwig. Hi.
Oh, the screen is you cannot see the screen?
We
see the screen, but it's frozen.
Ah, I know. This is what I was fearing.
Yeah, now the cursor moves.
My iPad to the thing. Yeah, so I don't know what can be done actually for that. It's frozen. Yes. Well, well, I will continue in words. Let me go back to my file. Okay. Yes, let me go back to my file. I will share the screen. And this is the beauty of these things. I mean, let me go here. Yeah. Okay. So let me go back. So anyway, I mean this. So what we did with Katia, if you want, was to develop algebraic geometry with a base which is not Z, because then you are stuck with rings, but with a base which is much, much smaller than Z, and which is known in algebraic topology to be the sphere spectrum. And it turns out that Graham Segal had developed the right notion, which is the notion of S algebra, or S ring, if you want, or gamma ring, in fact, in his words, which allows one to extend the framework of algebraic geometry to this much more general framework. And in fact, this framework is known in some guys to the people doing homotopy theory, like, you know, S.L. Holt or Dundas and so on, and doing their link with the algebraic case theory, because it is in fact the right place where topological cyclic homology is developed. So in fact, what happens is that when you do algebraic geometry over this base, you find out that there is a place as a ring, exactly as a ring, for this Adelka space, for this AMU, in fact. And there is a place also for projective space. And when you take H1 of this projective space with values in a natural shift, okay, and you plug it in the formula for the H0 over the scaling site, well, you get exactly, by the previous result, you get the spectral realization of the critical zeros of zeta. And now what this suggests, of course, is that there is some spectral sequence where, in fact, you know, one is computing an H1 of something more global, where this global thing is actually constructed over the scaling site with fibers, which are these projective spaces. So that's one direction, of course, that we would love to continue. And I mean, if you want, this direction is now sort of using sheaves, cohomology of sheaves, which is a very powerful thing. Why? Because when you look at the theorem, which I showed you before about the zeta cycles, it's not clear how with such a theorem you would be able to handle the multiplicity of a zero, or you would be able to handle the variation of the lengths and so on and so forth. Now the sheaf theory and sheaf cohomology does this in a perfect way. I mean, it's sort of tailored for that, for doing that. Okay, so in fact, I mean, the appearance, if you want, of this scaling site out of the blue, I mean, you know, as a parameter space, was extremely pleasing for us because, so as I said, okay, you have this S algebra and your projective space. I mean, it was extremely pleasing for us. And I would like to emphasize that because of the following links between non-commutative geometry and zeta. The previous links that we had, the first link that was found a long time ago was found by Bost and myself. It was the fact that there is a system of quantum statistical mechanics which has spontaneous symmetry breaking and which admits the Riemann zeta function as its partition function. So this was found in the beginning of the 90s. Then, what was more geometric, if you want, and more convincingly related to zeta, because the first one, okay, you have a partition function, but what about the zeros? So the second thing was that the Adelka space, which is a non-commutative space, which is dual to the BC system, is directly related to the zeros of the L functions. And not at all as a side thing, the quantized calculus, as I had explained in my two previous talks, is a key ingredient for the semi-local trace formula, which actually gives you a source of positivity for the veiled quadratic form. And with Katia, what we had shown in our paper on the semi-local trace formula, I mean on the veiled positivity, what we had shown is that in fact, the quantized calculus shows, okay, with a lot of work, that the veil quadratic form, when you restrict it without the primes, is actually larger than the contribution of the Sonnen space. And the Sonnen space appears completely naturally from the quantized calculus. And the advantage of this framework, of course, is that, okay, we did it for the Archimedean place only, but the whole framework, including the quantized calculus, including the semi-local trace formula, makes sense in general. They give you a formula for which the Sonnen space continues to exist and for which the main difficulties that one meets when dealing with the prolate functions and the angle between the two projections continues to hold. I mean, this is a small paper which we wrote for the, I have now to show you the papers. I mean, it's a small paper which we wrote for the Journal of Number Theory, which is called Quasi-Inner Functions at Local Factors. And in that paper, what we prove by holomorphic function, I mean, by a complex analysis, what we prove is that when we go now to the semi-local case where primes will be involved, it will still be true that the angle of Slepian and Pollack, I mean, the angle between these two projections, which continue to exist, is still a compact operator. So this means if you want that there will still be eigenvalues for this angle, there would be a full analysis, which has not been done, nobody has done it, that will be needed. And it will be needed in order to generalize our result on the veil positivity and trace formula from the Archimedean place to more places. Of course, you know, the one lesson that one learns from my talk is that because of these extremely tiny eigenvalues, it will be difficult. It will be difficult because if you want, you have to understand fully these very, very tiny eigenvalues. You probably have to condition the operator by these very tiny eigenvalues. And when we tried with Katia to condition this operator by the very tiny eigenvalues, we had a completely crazy idea, I have to say. And it is this crazy idea which is at the origin of this paper. The crazy idea was that, after all, if you condition by these very, very tiny eigenvectors by this subspace, okay, and if you look at the Dirac operator, if you look at just scaling, well, then you should get something which resembles the zeros of zeta. So that this is exactly when we started computing. That's exactly when we start computing. Now, so if you want, this development which I have been explaining is not at all disjoint from the general strategies that we have. In fact, it finds exactly its place, if you want, in the general strategy. And the only thing I can say is that, of course, I mean, you know, these things are sort of piling up, so it's a little bit difficult to follow. But I mean, if one wants to understand, one should start by a paper which we dedicated to Dan Voiculescu, which is the scaling Hamiltonian and which appeared in the Journal of Operator Theory. And it is in this paper that, everything got started because from this paper, we had the idea that using the semi-local trace formula, one could advance with the veil positivity. In fact, I mean, this was of course inspired by a very important work of him. And this is ongoing, but it's also related to another thing. It's also related to the work of Berry and Keating on what people call the Berry-Keating Hamiltonian, which is just the scaling Hamiltonian. And what it is related to, it's related to the fact that they make a cutoff, a very strange cutoff, by removing the neighborhood of the two axes. And what we understood with Katia is that, in fact, this cutoff is, in fact, exactly the cutting on the Sonnen space. So this paper is quite important to understand the general strategy. And then, okay, of course, I mean, from this paper, we went to the veil positivity and trace formula. That paper, the veil positivity and trace formula, is very technical. It's but it contains a very fundamental idea. It contains the fundamental idea that the root of the veil positivity is the Sonnen space. And so, I mean, the root of the very positivity is from Hilbert space. Now, you see the Hilbert space, which is used here when you take the semi-local formula, is completely canonical, exactly what I was explaining. There is no Sobolev space, there is nothing like that, as there was for when you take all places. Now, as I said, there is this other paper, quasi inner functions and local factors, in which the fundamental property of this pair of projections is proven, but using complex analysis. And but of course, we do not compute the angle, we do not compute the eigenfunctions, and so on. And you know, at the conceptual level, I would like to add the following thing, that many people, in fact, Berry and Keating and many other people, they had the illusion that they could tackle the Riemann hypothesis by only looking at what happens at the Archimedean place, or if you want, by only looking at the scaling Hamiltonian. But when you look with a good pair of glasses in the statistics of the eigenvalues, I mean, of the zeros of the Riemann zeta function, then what you find out is that these statistics is in fact not just the statistics which is coming from random matrices, from random Hermitian matrices. You find that there is an additional contribution which is irreducible and which is due to the primes. So this means that there is no chance that you will get anywhere by only sticking to the Archimedean place. You have to add the primes. And the beauty of the semi-local trace formula is that it adds the primes, plus the beauty of the veil formulation of the positivity, which tells you that you only have to consider finitely many primes at a time. I mean, this is an amazing fact, the fact that you only have to consider finitely many primes at a time, because after all, the Riemann hypothesis is about the behavior of infinitely many primes. It's about, if you want, the behavior at infinity. But no, the veil positivity is only to be checked for finitely many primes at a time. And this is what allows, if you want, the semi-local formulation to be present. Now, so our papers, I mean, among our papers, of course, there is this paper on absolute algebraic geometry, the affine case, which, as I said, you know, is used in order to get the shift theory working and to get an H1 behind the scene, which hopefully, you know, will be the H1 which one would expect to have from the, if you want, the analog of the cohomology that normally gives the zeros in the case of the function fields. Okay, so I think I am actually doing well with the time. And okay, so now I think I will just stop, you know, and.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's find the icon for clapping hands. And now we can go ahead with questions. There was one question during the talk. It was Adam Wegert. So Adam, now it's your chance to rock and roll. Please ask your question now.
Yes, I just wanted to go to the slide with this spectral triple.
Yeah, okay, let me go. Let me reach the spectral triple. I suppose you see my screen, but
yes.
Let me take the full screen, no?
Yeah, okay. we the full screen right now, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you want the first appearance of the spectral triple, huh? Yes.
Yes, I just wanted to ensure myself that the formula for the zero of lambda, in fact, does not depend from lambda. It's the only, lambda is only in the definition of the Hilbert space and the definition of the algebra, yes?
No, the zero of lambda is just minus I u by du, yes. It doesn't depend on lambda, yeah.
But lambda is present in this cutoff, yes, in this projection.
No. You see, look, I mean, if I look at the circle of lengths L, okay, and I write it multiplicatively, so I pass from R to R plus star, then because it has lengths L, I will be going from lambda inverse to lambda with periodic boundary conditions,
mm-hmm.
and this will be the operator. So, I mean, if you want, of course, the operator is acting on functions on this circle. So, and the length of the circle is changing.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
You see, I mean, spectral triples are very useful in that respect because, I mean, as you know, the spectral triple will give you back the geometry. So it will give you back, in particular, the length of the circle.
Uh-huh. Yes, sure, thank you.
Okay, Anybody else?
I have a question.
Go ahead, Tomek.
So absolute algebraic geometry was a hope for extending the Weyl conjectures to this context to as a way to prove the Riemann hypothesis. Is the appearance of this absolute algebraic geometry of the spectral spheres something in this direction?
Of course.
Makes it closer?
Of course. Mm-hmm. No. I mean, if you want in the trajectory that we followed with Katia, there were two things that had to be unveiled. And these things are parallel, but they are independent. I mean, the first thing that had to be unveiled might be, let me try to share my screen again. Eh? I mean, to share my iPad again. Okay. Let me try to share my iPad, otherwise I am a little bit difficult to answer. Okay, partager. I mean, this is I wish that there would be something more efficient. Okay, so you can see my iPad.
Yes, we see it.
Yeah, and now you will see this white piece.
Okay. Yeah, white page, yes.
So what happened in our trajectory with Katia was that, as I said, we there are two independent things which have to be understood. I mean, there is one thing which is algebraic, and there is one thing which is geometric. And in both of these cases, we are looking for a kind of absolute. So geometrically, what we found, if you want, is that what is really underlying a lot of stuff in a truly absolute manner is the arithmetic side. Now, this arithmetic side is a topos, which is just, if you want, the topos, which is underlying n cross. But this n cross should be sort of as being, oh shit, it doesn't work.
Yeah, again, it's frozen, I was about to say, yes.
This is awful.
But it's strange that it starts, it works for a while, and then it stops.
Yeah, this is strange. I mean, okay. I don't know what to do.
Can you try using this Zoom whiteboard?
Yeah, but this would take an hour. I mean, yeah, no, but let me tell it in words. I mean, okay, let me tell it in words. So let me just go to the no longer screen, partager. Uh-huh. Can you see my face here?
No, we see just you, but not screen.
Ah, not screen, okay. So let me partager again.
Yeah, now I can see your screen again. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, and let me see if I could do this. Yeah. Yeah, okay. So you see, okay. Somehow, as I was saying, you know, we were dealing with two problems of finding something absolute. There was one part which was finding something absolute in algebra, and one part which was finding something absolute in the geometry. Now, what we found in geometry is the arithmetic side. So the arithmetic side is a topos, which is simply the dual of n cross. Mm-hmm. So what does it mean? It means, in fact, this n cross, which appears there, you should think of it as being the root for the lambda operations. Namely, whenever you have an action of n cross somewhere, it is something which is occurring in this topos. And what is really extremely interesting is that this topos, when you look at it, it turns out to be related to the Hadelka space. And in fact, you have to work on it a bit. And at first with Katia, we were considering the simplest possible structure sheaf on n cross, and which was in characteristic one. And the reason why we were working in characteristic one is that when we work in that framework, what you find out is that there is a Frobenius for each n, which is raising x to the power n. And in characteristic one, this turns out to be an endomorphism. And that when you assemble all these n together, you get something about this arithmetic side. And that when you work a little more, you find that there is a refinement of the arithmetic side, which is a scaling side. So that was for the geometric part. For the geometric part, we are pretty confident that we found the right sort of absolute object. Now, on the algebraic side, it was much more difficult because what we found after a while is that while, if you want, the characteristic one was very pleasant for the reason which I just said, in fact, it was not something which was below spec Z, or if you want, it was something which was on the side of the finite characteristic of spec Z and so on. It was just on the side, it was not below. But the S algebras of the gamma rings, if you want, of Graham Segal, they are below everybody. And moreover, I mean, I remember, you know, hearing long time ago, there was a meeting in Oberwolfach where Goodwillie was. This was in the 80s. It was actually in 1987. And we had concocted a meeting where the people in cyclic homology would meet the people in algebraic topology, you know, in Waldhausen, algebraic case, and so on and so forth. And Goodwillie was there. And I was so impressed because Goodwillie was explaining that in the theory of spectra, in the sense, of course, of topologists, there is an object which is more primitive than spec Z. And this is the sphere spectrum. Now, the sphere spectrum, when you try to work with it and you are an analyst, I mean, you can forget about it because, you know, it takes infinite loop space and so on. I mean, you will never do analysis with that. But it turns out that it has an incarnation which is much more pleasant and which is the simplest S algebra, which is called S. And which is, if you want, a gamma ring in the sense of Graham Segal. So in fact, if you think more, you find out that this is the right place for cyclic homology. This base is better for cyclic homology than Z. Why? Because the cyclic permutations are incredibly better on that base than they are on spec Z. The root of this is the following. The root is that essentially, okay, I'm cheating, but essentially what happens when you take a tensor product, you know, imagine that I give you a ring and I take the tensor square of the ring. It's impossible to determine the fixed point of the flip that exchanges the two copies. I mean, it's there, of course, you can define it, but I mean, you cannot get a good hold of it. Whereas when you work over the algebra S and we work with primitive things, the tensor product is replaced by the smash product. And when you take the smash power of a set X, you find out that the fixed points are incredibly simple to get. They're just X itself, I mean, you know, so, and even for subgroup and so on. So, I mean, this fact, this very simple fact, is what is at the root of the link, which was found by, particularly by Esserlot, I mean, of the link between the topological psychic homologies, the Witt construction, and the Fontaine theory, for instance. So, I mean, you know, there is a wall open land there. And to answer your question about the veil and so on, okay, what we believe with Katia is that the correct sort of absolute algebraic geometry is the algebraic geometry over S.
Hey, Tomek.
Yes, but if you want to sue this absolute algebraic geometry with this
I didn't side. Understand the work, the word you say, if you want to sue to?
No, if you want to glue together absolute algebraic geometry and this scaling side.
No, it's not gluing. No, the scaling site is a geometric object, and the S algebra are the algebraic counterpart. So it's not a question of gluing. No, what you can do, I mean, what the formula which I showed, you know, if you look at the formula which I was showing before, which was this one. So here, if you want, what you had was A mu was an S algebra, okay? And then I use the algebraic geometry over S to have the projective space. And this means that then you can consider projective space over this S algebra. You see, and this S algebra actually, so this is, if you want, the algebraic side. Now, the reason why S algebras are infinitely better in that respect is that, as I said, you know, if you take a ring and you try to divide it by a subgroup, it's not a ring. It's something which you cannot understand. But if you think of a ring, or the content of the S algebra, what is it? It can be said in two words, and anybody can understand it. So instead of defining what is an S algebra, which would be too complicated, I can define you for you what is an S additive group, because algebra, then you just put in the product. So what is an S additive group? Well, when you have a normal additive group, abelian group, you can take any set and consider divisors with values in this group on the set X. It turns out that if you do that, what you get a functor from sets, set X, to sets, okay? This functor is covariant because you can push forward the divisor. And so essentially, I mean, that's what you have, okay? Now, when you have, so imagine now that I have something which is not an abelian group, okay? And which is more complicated. And for instance, I take a ring, I quotient it by a subgroup. Well, it turns out that you can still define divisors in this quotient with value in this quotient. What you do is you lift these divisors to the thing which is above, which is an ordinary stuff. And then you say when two divisors are equal. And they are equal when they are equivalent under the action of this group. And that's it, you are done. I have told you the whole story, okay? And so if you want these S algebras, they are infinitely more manageable in situations of quotients than are the ordinary algebras. They have the correct algebraic manipulation available. And so now you have to put that together with projective space, and it's really projective space over F1. So it's obtained by gluing, if you want, the affine space with itself in a very, very simple way, okay? And then when you put these two things together, then you can consider the H1 of the sheaf and over H0 and so on, and okay. And so if you want the Adel class space, or scaling site of the Adelka space is occurring here. It's also occurring here. So we are kind of on the square of the scaling site, kind of. But the two sides are not treated in the same way.
Mm-hmm.
You see, but we are kind of on the square.
Yeah, I was thinking about your proposed spectral sequence.
Yes, yeah.
So in the spectral sequence, I try to imagine some vibration of some geometric objects.
The geometric objects are these ones, yes, yeah, fibered over the scaling site.
Over S. So this means that what is absolute in the sense of algebraic geometry lives above this.
Exactly, this is correct. This is what you have in mind is perfectly correct. Yeah, but if you want, we are still very far from understanding this stuff. We have not even written the paper which is showing this formula. There are two sides which are very different in mathematics. There is a side where you make experiments, you play with a computer and so on, and eventually you understand. And there is a side which, is sort of occupied by the Grothendieck soul, you know, where you work with sheaves and so on and with abstract stuff. And eventually you will land on Earth. And that one is on that side, on the Grothendieck side, where you have sheaves and so on. But I am always amazed by the incredible efficiency of sheaves. I'm always amazed by that because they are so fine. They really do exactly what you would like to do, to relate the various coverings with each other, not adding anything superfluous and so on. And in a way which is extremely delicate because after all, these zeta cycles, they vanish for all values of the length except a countable set, which are the sets which are integral multiples of the inverse of zeros of zeta. So, the fact that a sheaf can handle that is always miraculous to me.
I have another question. You said something about geodesics.
Yes.
And it is well known that geodesics on the Gromov boundary sphere.
Yes.
Of hyperbolic geometry is very important in arithmetic geometry.
Yes.
Is there a relation?
Well, this I don't know. I mean, let me come back to that. This is, of course, you know, a kind of burning question, because, I mean, when you, exactly. I mean, you know, so what happens is like this, you know, I mean, these things are telling you, look, we are just circles. Okay, and I mean, the only thing you need to know whether we are zeta cycles or not is something which will be stable under cover, and which is, after all, extremely simple, because it's just saying that this subspace is not dense in the Hilbert space of L2 functions. So it's something, you know, which, so what one is missing is a kind of genial idea of transforming this condition into the condition that it's closed geodesic in some space. You see? This is what is missing. Mm-hmm. Now, what should this space be looking like? It should be like a cusp, because these geodesics will be shorter and shorter. Their length is 2 pi over the nth zero of zeta. So they will be shorter. By the way, I cannot see your face. Whom are you?
I can see Tomek.
I can see my face.
Yeah.
I cannot see his face.
Yeah, he's visible.
Whom is it?
Tomek's face is visible. I mean, he has some nice background, but his face is visible.
But I cannot see. I cannot see even whom it is.
I cannot help with this, because on my two screens I see him.
Well, but you are lucky you have two screens. Anyway, it doesn't matter. I mean, you know, this is like questions coming from above.
Exactly.
So I mean, I think, you know, this is the most, this is how to say, the most mystifying question, in fact. Because, okay, so we got away because we said, you know, the base is a scaling site and so on. But okay, but I mean, there has to be another answer, which is more geometric, and which one would, where one would find, you know, an idea of how to find the geometric space. I don't know if it would be related to the, you see, first let me tell you, it cannot be related to Zellberg. I mean, Zellberg, of course, was looking for a cusp, because he was taking the quotient by SL to Z. And, but his cusp didn't have the right properties, because there was a minus sign in the trace formula. And moreover, there was a square also. So, but the one we are talking about, it is a kind of cusp, I mean, but it's still very mysterious. I mean, and the point, you know, is that, as I said, it was found by accident. It was found by accident, because first there was this crazy idea to take the conditioning from the veil and to look at the corresponding spectral triple. That was the first thing. And then the second accident was that it was totally by accident that we found, you know, that, that we found, if you want, that we found this by accident, totally. We are plotting the two graphs by curiosity, and we found that they were touching each other. And that not only they were touching each other, but where they were touching was the place where things were taking place, you know. And then when you plot the eigenvalues, I mean, okay, what you find, and from that you get the idea of a zeta cycle, mm-hmm. from this touching. You know,
is this touching tangential?
Yeah, of course it is tangential, because there is this graph is always below this graph and below this one, so they are ordered, if you want, this graph. They are below each other. They don't cross each other. This is a question of eigenvalues, you know, operators, and so on. And so they are ordered. So in fact, this is what you find. But this was found by accident. This was found by accident. And that's what I like about mathematics. You know?
A physical explanation of these tangencies.
Well, the explanation of the tangencies is
resonant phenomenon.
I don't know. I don't know. I mean, you know, I don't know. I mean, it's just a fact. I mean, the amazing fact is that where they touch is exactly the zero of zeta. I mean, you know, this is the discovery. And then, you know, when you know that these curves, they are pinned down. It's like if you had nails, you know, you have naves. These naves form a geometric progression, but when you go to higher eigenvalues, the geometric progression will become shorter and shorter and shorter. So these graphs will have to look more and more like zero dot zeta. You know? I mean, the spectral triples. Now, I don't know in which way one could take a limit of the spectral triples for the lengths going to infinity that would converge exactly to zero dot zeta. This I don't know. I mean, but of course, I mean, these questions are open.
Okay, thank you very much.
By the way, Alain, can you see Tomek now? I put him
no,
in
but the... what is his name? You say Thomas, but I don't even know.
Tomasz Maszczyk.
Ah, okay, okay. Good.
Can you see him now? Because I put him in the spotlight.
Spotlight? I know. I don't see anybody in the spotlight.
Ah, I know because you are sharing the screen.
This yeah, is okay, okay, let me stop sharing. Yes.
You can see him
he?
Now.
Where is he? Where is he? I don't see him.
I'm here.
Ah, okay, okay. I see you. Okay, good. Okay, good. Good. I mean, it's good to, you know, I was just hearing the voice from outside.
Yeah, I know the feeling. I know the feeling. Now, anybody else would like to ask a question? Please go ahead.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about the theorem on zeta cycles.
Yes.
As far as I remember, its formulation includes division by S. So is it true that your theorem automatically implies that there are no real zeros of zeta?
Oh yeah, but that's trivial, sure. No. I mean, this.
Yeah, sure, it's trivial for zeta, but maybe we can somehow adapt your construction
no,
to
no,
L function.
No, because the Fourier transform is really on the critical line. So, I mean, you restrict to the critical line from the start.
Yeah, of course, but.
Yeah, no, I see what you mean. Yeah, okay. No, I mean, I don't think there is. No, I mean, I would doubt that. I would doubt that. Where your question is very right is a different story. It is in the paper with Katia on the semi-local, on the, you know, this paper, which is very hard to read on the Archimedean case of the veil positivity. Because there we have a condition which is a vanishing at zero. So for that, yes, yeah. For that paper, yes. But I mean, this is much more, if you want, difficult and technical. I mean,
okay, thank you.
Okay, anybody else? I don't see any raised hands.
Maybe just one more question.
Okay, go ahead, Adam.
I just wanted to ask, is there any link between zeros of zeta and not the spectrum of D itself, but the dimension spectrum of the spectral triple?
No, I mean, this is a different story. This is quite a different story. I mean, this would go rather in the sense of, for instance, what Lapidus and so on were doing. But I mean, it's not the dimension spectrum. Not the dimension spectrum. It's really, if you want, here, if it were a dimension spectrum, it would be more like fractals and so on. But here it's not. I mean, it's really, you know, the spectrum itself. It's not
okay,
a dimension spectrum.
Okay, but still, is it possible to compute the dimension spectrum of the spectral triple or?
Oh, well, the dimension spectrum is obvious because it's a finite rank perturbation of the Dirac, so the dimension spectrum doesn't change. It's the same. It's the same as for the circle.
It's for the circle, yes. As for the circle.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have a question. I think you mentioned Bost-Kahn, and I'm wondering if KMS states do come into this picture.
Ah, no. No, I mean, what happened, it's more of a kind of a, you know, a funny perspective because the paper with Bost was the reason why I got invited in 1996 for the anniversary of at Heisenberg. I got invited, I was surprised to be invited. So I was invited in Seattle for the anniversary of Heisenberg. And because of this paper with Bost and the KMS states and so on. And then, you know, I gave my talk. And after my talk, Heisenberg came to see me and he told me, you know, it's not clear that your work would be related to zeros of the Riemann zeta function. Okay, so I took it, you know. And then I came back from Seattle and I had a kind of 9 hours jet lag, which is always difficult to handle. But my wife was kind enough that she allowed me to stay on the Seattle time. Mm-hmm. So I was staying on Seattle time. And I was not working. I was reading, this book, which you probably have read, which is a great book, which I really like, which is called The Right Stuff, which is about Apollo 13 and so on. So I was not working at all. I was just in my bed in the middle of the night reading, reading that book. I guess nowadays this would be impossible because we have email, we have reports to write and so on and so on. So, but at that time it was still possible. So for 1 week, I was not doing anything except reading this book, thinking. And after one week, I got up in the middle of the night and I said, shit, of course, the dual of the busy system is giving the right space. And I mean, what was obvious to me is that it was giving the right veil formula, the explicit formula. It was giving the right hand side of the veil formula, namely the contribution of the places. But then I started thinking about the spectral side, and it amazingly it worked out with a minus sign and so on. So I mean, this is propaganda. I mean, propaganda for, you know, being idle. Forget about your email. Forget about that people are pestering you that you have to write this report within 2 days. You know, just think. Just be idle. You know, just be idle. Leave the brain to live its own life. You know.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And by the way, the book that I wrote, you know, with Danny Chéreau and Jacques Dixmier, is exactly advocating this point of view. I mean, I think George can testify on that. I mean, the hero, you know, he receives this spectrum from a friend of him, from an observatory in Atacama. And his friend tells him, please come urgently because we received this from distant, probably aliens and so on, and we don't know at all what it is. And when the guy arrives in ALMA, you know, the big telescope in Atacama, he learns after taking the plane and so on, he learns that his friend is in the hospital with a stroke. So he cannot talk to his friend. And so he inherits this spectrum. And instead of, of course he cannot talk to his friend. So what he does, he leaves his computer, he leaves everything, and he goes for a trip alone. And eventually he reaches the ultimate south of South America, in a lost island there, and he spends months. And the most funny part was written by Jacques Dixmier. It is the time when this poor guy, after his trip, he lands in St. Helens, you know, the island where Napoleon finished his days.
Yeah.
And he's so desperate in trying to understand the spectrum that he compares it with the dates of the battles of Napoleon. So he plots on one side the dates of the victories or the defeats of Napoleon, and he tries to compare these dates with the spectrum. So I mean, so this is to tell you how desperate he is about understanding the spectrum. But anyway, I mean, you know, I like to make this propaganda. By the way, this book has not been translated into English. I mean, not the first book and not this book, which I think is a pity because. I mean, as I was saying before, you know, now with Google Translate, it would be an easy job to do. It's I don't know why it has not been done. It's a, kind of a gift to Dixmier.
Ludwig, do you want to ask a question?
I have two, well, simple questions. I don't know. Alan, do you think this Hausdorff distance can help about convergence of the spectral
tables? Well, that's a very good question. This is an excellent question. This is an excellent question because in the following sense that if there is any kind of limit, if you want, of these spectral triples when L goes to infinity, it should be caught by the Hausdorff-Gromov distance. Yeah, but not in a simple way. Huh? I mean, one will have to be very tricky. But you see, the difficulty by looking at one single object is that, of course, the spectrum grows like the spectrum of the Dirac on the circle. So it doesn't have the same growth as the eigenvalues, as the zeros of zeta. But of course, when you go to a limit, things change. I mean, you know, so I mean, it's like, and it corresponds exactly to what you say. I mean, what we have obtained, if you want, with Katea, is an understanding of the low-lying part. Of course, larger and larger, as large as you want. This is not a problem. Whereas people in random matrix theory have understood the statistics, as I said, forgetting the primes. Huh? But what is also very funny, and I have no explanation for that, is that their understanding of the statistics uses the prolate functions again. Because the statistics of Hermitian matrices is based, thanks to the work of Gaudin, on prolate functions. So, I mean, you know, there is a lot waiting to be understood there. I mean, it's clear, you know, it's completely clear. But it's not trivial at all. It's not trivial at all because the prolate we use are in the additive realm, whereas the prolate Gaudin is using are in the multiplicative realm. I mean, they are the same function, but you have a change of variable. So it's really, I mean, you know, it's really quite tough.
Okay, second one is kind of a comment that there is a lot of people working on so-called signal analysis, and in which case they observe it. Well, we have a paper with Gianni Landi also and Franz Lueff relating geometry of non-commutative torus or lattice of Heisenberg relations.
Yes.
To particular solutions or solitons, actually, for harmonic.
And
we found one, the Gaussian, and the higher solitons would be, I think, one of the Hermit functions. So,
yes.
Some relation also.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you know, the signal analysis. I mean, if you want what is pure in the Slepian and Pollack, is the fact that they don't use more than the pair of projections. So, I mean, yes. This is the purest way you can do it. I mean, they actually, you know, diagonalize the angle. I mean, this is amazing. It's amazing.
Where our harmonic maps are actually from two-point set torus, which means we need one projection. projection.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Well, there has to be a relation, of course.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you, Ludwig. Anybody else? Any further questions or comments? I'm scrolling through the audience to see if there are any raised hands, but I don't see any. Katia, would you like to weigh in as a co-author?
I'm not sure you hear me.
We can hear you. We can see your picture and we can hear you.
Okay. Yes, I mean, maybe a comment to the question about geometry versus algebra.
Mm-hmm.
So what Alain mentioned of this A mu, so I guess he's thinking of applying the H functor. So there is a functorial link between, the category of commutative rings, for example, or even a weaker structure, the category of S algebras. And this is the translation for rings, for example, is in terms of the Eilenberg Maeterlinck functor. And for semi-rings, this story can be generalized for weaker structure than quotient, like what Alain talked about. So there is an absolute geometry, in fact, which is given by the topos. Then it's the coefficients that they are much more workable and flexible if understood in terms of this fancy combinatoric starting from the category of gamma sets, a single category. And so this two view of the absolute is because, for example, in cohomology, you have a space like our scaling site, but you have also to deal with coefficients when you take cohomology, which is becoming obviously homotopy because this is the shifting working over S. Homotopy theorists talk about homotopies, higher homotopies. So these two aspects are connected at the moment when you take this cohomology of the topos. And so it's the full absolute structure is given for the space, as I said, in terms of the scaling site. For the coefficients, absolute again, in terms of making absolute a algebraic structure that in terms of rings was not yet absolute because the category was not the most rooted one. And so this is the virtue of the application of S algebras dealing with coefficients, making the coefficients absolute, characteristic free in other terms, because when you work with rings or even in the sense we worked before in characteristic one, there was this characteristic one, so still hanging on, or characteristic P. But when you talk about S algebras, you really are absolute characteristic free. And the story starts very combinatorically. And then what they do in a multiple theorist, well, they have sophisticated gadgets that Alain mentioned in the talk, looping. But we wanted to retain the most rooted form of this absolute algebraic aspect. So without moving, without passing to homotopies, rather retaining the roots of the construction. And in the way you can do it is just working with this S-algebra machine. In these terms, you see there is a change of gear from the traditional approach as in with rings and semi-rings, which is set theoretically, to a categorical approach. So you leave working with set, but in fact you work with functors from the start. So category theory enter in as a substitution of set theory. And this is for the coefficients. So there are these two aspects of absolute that they are very intriguing. The second part of what we plan to work out right now is this topos, cohomology of topos, but then what they are not absolute now. So the geometry is the geometry of the Adair class space, which support, in quote, what happened with the Riemann zeta function, and the coefficients are written in a way which is characteristic free. This is what I add.
Yeah, thank you very much. All right. Anybody else would like to weigh in? Richard? Nope.
Can I ask Katia this time?
Yeah. Okay.
Beautiful explanation, but I would like to dig deeper. Do you have in the case of your cohomology, an analog of a Lefschetz formula for an absolute, some absolute Frobenius?
Well, this is you pick into the technical part of this algebraic geometry. Already, what Alain said has to be, and you inquired already with the spectral sequence. So there is a certain machinery in arithmetic geometry, in algebraic geometry, that has worked extensively, especially in view of what the Lind prove with the Bell conjectures. So these Lefschetz traits, this spectral triple, but as you said, you figured it out correctly, and in fact, we both agree that the interesting part, it will happen on the fibers of this, I remember your question before. So the root of the story is on the fiber in a way which is essentially similar of the proof of the Bell conjecture by the linear, where the interesting part is over the fiber after reduction, so to the curve case, but the interesting part is over the fiber. So there is this base space, there is the base that is there, and it's absolute, so it's good per se. But over the fiber, there is a very technical machine which we brought out of the work of Alain on the trace formula. So if anything happened in terms of, I mean, the trace formula will show, appear in the fiber of this fourth vibration that we are thinking about.
Thank you very much.
Okay. All right, it's been a very long day. So there are no further questions from anybody. Let us...
Just one more.
Okay, yes, okay.
For this Gram of Hausdorff distance, okay, so this is still open, how to make sense of the limit of this spectral triple, but what one expect that in the limit we will get a type one spectral triple or some other fancy notion, like for example, twisted one or something like this?
Well, qualitatively, it's very easy to see what you should get if you want, because if you want the growth of the eigenvalues of the Riemann zeta function is differing from the case of the circle by an additional log. You know, there is an additional log in the counting of the eigenvalue. So, I mean, this is easy to qualitatively imitate by taking a product of a circle by a quantum sphere or something like that. I mean, this is, I mean, if you want to reach something qualitatively, this is not difficult. What is difficult is to, I wouldn't bet that one can take a limit of these spectral triples, because as I said, you know, they are pinned down by certain nails. Mm-hmm. But because they vary continuously, they can still fluctuate a lot. So I wouldn't bet. I think if you want the idea of the closed geodesics is much stronger than trying to take a limit. At first we try to take a limit, but you know, I fear that this is not a good idea, because what we really understand are the nails, you know, are the zeta cycles. These are the real things. I mean, the rest, you know, it could be that these things after a while begin to fluctuate too much. So, I mean, I have no intuitive feeling about that.
Okay, thank you.
So what you are saying is that the limit might simply not exist, right?
Sure. I mean, if you want, in the most reasonable guess would be that except for these nails, which pin mm-hmm. down these things at the zeta cycles, they might fluctuate a lot. You know. Yep. I mean, this would be the most likely. Of course, I mean, then it could be that if you take a suitable limit in probability or whatever, you get the right thing. But that wouldn't, I wouldn't like that. I mean, that wouldn't convince me. You know, mm-hmm. I'm sure it's possible to do that, but that wouldn't convince me. No.
Okay. So, anybody else? George?
Thanks for organizing this.
Our pleasure. Okay, I think it's the high time to
thanks a lot.
Alan again. So let's clap hands again. So bye-bye. Thank you so much. This was a great experience. Thank you all for coming. And let me say that the last seminar of the semester in a week is by Nigel Hickson. And it will be about Baumkorn conjecture, Oka principle, and Langlands something, I forgot what. but the abstract is very, very interesting. And I hope to see you there in a week. And for the time being, Alain, thank you very much again for your talk. It's been a pleasure and a feast. This is a real feast of mathematics. And thank you for delivering. I stop recording. Thank you very much. Thank you all.